here together as a body of believers, for to focus on God, on His Word, and on Him making us more and more like His Son Jesus. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, thank you for being so good to us. Thank you for bringing us salvation. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for Jesus and the resurrection. Thank you for so many great things you've given us. Help us to focus our hearts and minds on your goodness, on your mercy, on your grace, that we might absorb it into our lives, we might practice it, we might give it out to those around us Monday through Saturday, Father God. Bless us today in all that we do so that it might glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, since Harold's off preaching and assisting at another church, he elected me to do announcements this morning. So, here we go. Today it says Wings, Women's and God's Service will meet at 1 p.m. at Don Julio's restaurant in Wake Forest. All women of Unity are invited to attend. Man, I'm going to Don Julio's. So, enjoy, ladies. October 11th, which is Tuesday, I believe. We'll be doing the produce boxes at the church office at 1:15 in the morning. Wednesday, we have Wednesday Bible study at the church building at 2 p.m. And on October 14th, Friday, we have small group Bible study at 6:30 p.m. Do we know where it's at this week?
TBD.
TBD. Determined. Okay, to be determined. Got it. So I'm looking at people right now. Who can we pick on there? October 15th, this upcoming Saturday, we have a Love Life Prayer Walk at 9 a.m. meeting in Raleigh, North Carolina. We'll hear a lot more about that today from Beth and Tiago. And that's the end of the announcements as I have them. Tiago has something he'd like to say as well, and I'm turning things over to him.
All right, good morning, good morning. It's good to be with you again. Just a few extra things. Just keep Harold in your prayers. He's over at Mary's Chapel, which is somewhere around here. They're having homecoming, and they invited him to do their preaching today. So keep him in your prayers. I think their service starts right now as well. So this Tuesday, as Chris mentioned, we're having the food boxes, the distribution. If you can show up to help, we start packing them around 10:30. So if you're able to help, we meet at the garage around 10:30, and we're usually done packing by 11:30, and we often need help carrying some boxes around. So if you're able to come, even if you can't make it to by 10:30 to help pack the boxes, if you're able to be here to then drive them to different places, we would appreciate your help. So this Tuesday at 10:30. And another last announcement is on November 9th, which is the second Sunday of November, we're going to have a business meeting, a church business meeting. This is when we're going to discuss how we use our finances, the decisions we're making in our church. And as you know, we as Baptists, we don't hand down decisions from the top down, right? We want decisions to be made by the congregation, being led by the Spirit. So that's what these business meetings are for. However, in our bylaws, the business meetings are said to take place on Wednesdays. Being that Wednesdays have switched to a 2 o'clock meeting, and a lot of our people can't make it to the 2 o'clock on Wednesdays, we need to change our bylaws so that our bylaws would be open for us to have a business meeting any day, really. So we're going to vote on that in order to amend our bylaws. So 2 weeks from today, during our morning service, we're going to have a vote to change the bylaws so that we can have a business meeting any day. Okay? And then on the 9th, that's when we'll have, if it passes, we'll have a business meeting on a Sunday morning. All right, that we want to encourage you to be part of it. That's why we wanted to do it during a Sunday morning, so that you guys who normally can't make it on Wednesday can be here. We want you to see how are we using our finances, what are the decisions we're making. We want you to be a part of that. Okay? So 2 weeks from today, we'll vote. If it passes, 2 weeks after that, we have our business meeting. Make sense? Very good. All right. Without further ado, I want to introduce Beth. Beth is one of the directors. Is that right? One of the directors with Love Life, the organization that we've been talking about over the last month or so. And so she's going to share a little bit more about what this upcoming week and Saturday is going to look like for us. So Beth, do it, please.
Thank you.
Here it is.
All right. Thank you so much for having me this morning. I want to thank you, Unity Baptist Church, and Pastor Tiago for taking a stand strong for life and partnering with Love Life. So as he mentioned, my name is Beth Mull, and I'm the area director for Love Life in this area. And your church has adopted a week and has signed up to come out and pray with us on our 40-week journey of hope. And you've adopted week 36. We do 40 weeks of our prayer journey, so you guys are at the tail end. We're about to finish on November 12th. We've been out at our local abortion center praying for 35 weeks, and it's been amazing. This year, we've already had 75 babies saved from abortion at our clinic. So God is really moving, and we're excited for you to share in it with us. Last year, we were able to reach over 200 moms, and there were 200 baby saves there as well. So God's on the move, and we're excited that you're going to join us. I wanted to share with you a video, Alicia's testimony.
Yeah, it will
get that video. Yeah.
I didn't know who Christ was until almost 3 years ago.
It was something that I believed in, but I didn't have a passion about being pro-life and standing for babies.
Days that we're living in and all the turbulent times going on right now, that wasn't a time to be a Christian and sitting on the bench.
I learned about Love Life in February, at the end of February. I started volunteering and going out there on the sidewalk.
January 24th of 2021 is when we first started Love Life here in Southern California.
We went to our boot camp training in February. It was like, well, let's do it.
So I walk up and there's nobody on the sidewalk. And I say, Lord, okay, there's only 5 more minutes left. And I ran over really quick, and this young, beautiful woman rolls down her window about this much. And she said, yes. And I looked at her and I smiled and I said, I don't know what you are here for, but if you have missed your menstrual cycle, your baby has a heartbeat, 10 fingers and 10 toes, and I can show you what your baby looks like today. When I was young, I had an abortion. I was 21. I was pregnant the second time. I had a miscarriage, and I was devastated because I really wanted to keep the baby. And sitting there in the ultrasound with her, I told her, she gave me a present that no money could ever compare. It was a blessing to see a baby on an ultrasound because I didn't get that on my first. And I got to hear a heartbeat because I never found one with my second baby. It was a Thursday, and I said, tomorrow is Good Friday. Would you like to go to church with me on Easter? And she said, yeah, that would be nice. We went to church. We sat together. And at the very end, Pastor Jack did the altar call. It was so beautiful. She got up, a woman I just met about a week, in front of an abortion clinic, is now choosing not only life for her baby, but eternity with the Lord.
I found out that I was pregnant at 3 months. I got already out of my head, like, I wanted someone to change my mind or give me some type of hope or something before I go in there. I was just, like, so excited. Like, I just wanted to tear up the baby. I was just so happy to see a life moving in me. I just knew in my heart that I was keeping her. That day, like, I called everyone and I was like, I'm keeping my baby. I don't care what anyone thinks, I'm keeping her.
Received a text message that not only was a baby saved, but a mom is now a part of the family of God.
I remember when Anna called and told me, and I think her exact words were, it was an amazing day of grace.
We had a gender reveal party for her. We had a baby shower for her. The word got to me that she's being baptized by Pastor Jack. And she wants you to be there, to be a part. It's a moment I'll never forget. As she came out of the water, just the laughter, and realized, thank you, Jesus.
were we just a part of like a miracle, a life being saved? And then more stories start happening and more women start getting saved. This happened last week and this happened yesterday. I pray to the God of heaven and earth, watch him work, and then we will see revival in our
life. I pray that love will spread faster than the wildfires we have here in California. And I want it to be a revival.
God calls us to do things that we think are impossible. Because God wants to stretch you. He wanted to stretch me.
You see, God will start to change your life. Even if you're not looking for it.
The Lord is moving her. He is using her. She's even actually gone out and is now counseling and trying to encourage other girls to keep their babies. I know God is moving in her life and he's not going to stop.
Just looking at baby names, I see Nora, I'm like, oh, I never, that's a nice name. It also means grace of God. So it's just like, oh, she's my little grace of God. So that's why I chose her name.
I don't want to just have these beautiful young women at these clinics choose life for their baby. I want to walk in life with them. And this is why Love Life has just changed me. But I know the Lord's hands is in it because he's changed my heart. A heart of stone into a heart.
And as a result of the church showing up, Alicia and Amari's lives were saved. So the mission of Love Life is to unite and mobilize the local church to create a culture of love and life that will end the abortion and orphan crisis. Can everybody say end?
End.
End. We actually want to see abortion in our country, and especially in North Carolina. But in order to do that, the churches all in our community need to unite, and we need to stand together. This is the number one moral issue of our day, and it has been hijacked to become a political issue, but we know as believers, this is a biblical issue. And so we feel like it is time for the church to respond. So we're creating a culture where families stop running to their local abortion center and begin running to the local church in an unplanned pregnancy. And we don't believe politicians will end abortion. We believe that the church uniting and mobilizing will end abortion and the orphan crisis. So politicians are downstream from culture. We hear in the media and in the news that Christians are downstream from culture. But we're saying no. We as Christians, if we unite and mobilize and stand for life and stand for the gospel, we can influence culture. And the politicians will follow us. So the tragic truth of abortion is that the leading cause of death in the U.S. is not cancer, heart disease, or even COVID. The leading cause of death is abortion. Let that settle in. 17,000 babies die every week through abortion, and abortion in North Carolina is allowed up to 20 weeks. There have been two babies at 21 weeks that were born that have survived. In North Carolina, we allow it for 20 weeks. A Woman's Choice here in Raleigh, which is the clinic that we go to and pray, they do 60 to 100 abortions every week. And since the overturning of Roe v. Wade, we have an increase in moms coming to our clinic. North Carolina is now known as an abortion haven. Our governor has stated that any woman who needs an abortion can come here to North Carolina and get one. And 56% of the abortions at our clinic are now from out of state. So it is really, really important that there's a Christian witness at every abortion center. There are 700 in the U.S. There are 200 of those that are covered with a Christian witness. That leaves 500 clinics that have no Christian witness. And we know that when the church shows up, abortions go down. Even our presence, even if we do not get to talk to somebody there at the center, our outreach team, it goes down. People do not want to come to a center that has a Christian witness there. We know that 54% of women and men identify as Christians. They've been in church the month of their abortion. So we know that there are people in this congregation and congregations all around the country that their women have abortion in their past. And we want you to know that we are a ministry of healing and restoration. So there is no condemnation in our ministry. If you have an abortion in your past, we have a ministry, a Bible study called Restored Life, where you women and men who have it in their past can come get healing and be freed from their abortion. And then we know that God uses them for our ministry, which is an awesome way for God to redeem our pasts. So a look back. So Love Life started actually in Charlotte 6 years ago. You'll go to that next slide. I'm missing that slide. That's okay. I'll go over this with you. We started 6 years ago in Charlotte, but since then we have expanded to 16 different cities, Raleigh being one of them, and we're getting ready to expand Chapel Hill, our site. We're also going to have prayer walks in Chapel Hill because there's also an abortion center there. And since we started, there have been 4,600 saves. So you saw Alicia, that's just one of 4,600 since we started. And as I mentioned, we had 75 just this year. And we've also had over 100,000 prayer walkers nationwide. This year in Raleigh, we've had 2,500 prayer walkers. Isn't that awesome? We just started in February. So we've had 2,500 Christians come out and pray. When you come to our prayer walk, we are not activists. We do not yell out at people. We do not hold song signs. We are a prayer ministry. We are bringing prayer to the darkest place of our city. There is no other place that we know of where people are actually appointed to die other than your local abortion center. And so we come and we bring the church. We sing, we worship the Lord, we go through prayer points, we pray for everybody involved in abortion. We even pray for the people out there, protesters, whomever might be out there that week. We pray that God would open their eyes and that they would know the truth. And then we have an outreach team where you have to be trained that reaches out to moms in a loving and kind way and says, hey, your baby has a heartbeat. You're already a mom. God doesn't make mistakes. Your baby is not a mistake, and we want to help you. And then when a mom chooses life, we then partner her with a local church that will walk with her for 1 to 2 years. So it's a myth that the pro-life ministry doesn't care about the parents. We want the parents to know Christ, and we want to help them parent their children. So we know that prayer is the key. We bring church to the darkest place of our city, and we worship, pray, and speak truth over this place. And one day we hope to see it completely closed. Did I get an amen?
Amen.
So at the end of our 40-week journey of hope, we do what we call week 40, which we'd love to have you guys participate. I know you're coming Saturday, but our week 40 is November 12th. It's where we invite every church. We have 53 church partners. We invite every church to come back and we celebrate the lives that were saved. And right now, we have 4 babies coming that we can literally see they were saved from our clinic. You can actually pinch our baby's cheeks that survived abortion. Their mom said yes to life, and we've been walking with that mom. So it would be a huge celebration. So this next video is just last year's celebration. I want you to see this.
Thank you. greatest moral issue of our time. It deserves our attention. It deserves our prayers. It deserves our focus. It's time for God's people to come out of the closet about what we believe and to take a bold stand for godliness. There was a young girl that was out on the sidewalk that day when that mom came for an abortion. And God used a young girl that said yes to Jesus as she was out there being faithful to King Jesus to turn the heart of that mom around, to begin loving her child and make the choice for life. So I'm speaking to the young generation. I'm speaking to the older generation and everybody in between. Everyone can do something. Acts 17:26 tells us this, that God picked the time and the place in which we would live. You had no say where you were going to be born or the time period in which you were going to be born. God decided that for you. But what you must decide in this moment is how you're going to live in that time and in that place. How are you going to live? How will you be remembered? What story will you tell when you get to heaven and you sit around the marriage supper of the Lamb? What will be your testimony that you will give? We have one life to live, church. Let it be about building His kingdom and not ours.
Yeah, so that is an example of our prayer walks all over the country. So we all do our Celebration of Life November 12th, so you guys are invited to that as well. This coming Saturday, there's two other churches with you guys, which is incredible just to see other churches standing for life, so we'll all walk together. And we have anywhere from 50 to 200 people there every Saturday walking for life and praying. So it's an awesome opportunity to be with the body of church all around us in our area. So I hope that you guys can attend. So if you were handed a vision booklet, if you'll open that up to page 10, what we're doing here today is hearing the tragic truth. This is the first part of your adoption. You're getting educated on abortion in your city. And then on Wednesday, we pray and fast. All the churches that are connected with us pray and fast. So we're asking you to do that, and you will get emails on Wednesday that you can pray through, either come together and do it or pray at home. And then on Saturday is our walk. It's our mission trip where we come out together and we pray for the end of abortion. And the last piece is to connect. You can connect with us and do other pieces of our ministry. We have sidewalk outreach where you reach out to moms and we train you. We need mentors. When a mom chooses life, we need people to walk with mom and hopefully dad. And then we need prayer walk champions to help us set up on Saturdays and come be part of our ministry. So you can be involved in many different ways other than the walk. And so on page 10 of your vision booklet, there's a little tear out and there's a QR code. If you're techie, you can do the QR code, but you can sign up. Also, on the back, you can just sign up with your name and sign up your husband and wife, if you can. You can just put both names on there and emails. And then I'll be in the back at a table around the corner, and you can hand them in to me. So I hope and pray you'll be there. It is an awesome experience to come and see God move in the hearts of people who are broken and they're in a crisis, and we show up and God uses our presence. So I hope that you guys will join us. And I'll be at the back for any questions. I know I see a lot of children here, and this can be a tough subject, but we do encourage children to come. We keep them in the center of the prayer group, and it is a way to tell your children about this. They will find out from school about this issue. So it's a great way to educate your own children before they find out from a friend what abortion is, and they get a different perspective. So we bring your children and bring friends. You can bring people from other churches. You can bring family members. The more Christians we have out there, the more moms choose life. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Beth. Thank you. And as she mentioned, if you guys have any questions, please talk to her. She'll be in the back after the service. This Saturday, as she said, we're going. The prayer walk begins at 10.
No.
It begins at 9.
Okay.
All right. But we need to be there at least 15 minutes before so we can sign up. Please register so that we have an idea of who's going, because then that way we'll link you to receive emails and more information as well. We will give you the address where we're going to meet. We're going to aim to be there at the latest 8:45, but we will also have people meeting here. If you want to follow or go carpool together, we can meet here at, we're going to aim to leave here no later than 8 o'clock from the church parking lot. Okay, so if you want to carpool with us, that's going to be an option this Saturday, right? And we also have some of our women ministry has some questions about donation and things like that. And so please speak with Beth afterwards. All right. Any other questions for the moment? One last thing comes to mind. On Wednesday, as Beth mentioned, I really want you, even if whether you come to our Wednesday study or not, take time during your day on Wednesday to pray. Pray over those points that are on there. And fast if you're able to, whether that means you skip your lunch and use that time to pray, whether it's fasting from something that's central in your life, rather than turning on the TV early in the morning, you fast from TV on Wednesday. And every time you would normally watch TV, you pray. Right? So fasting means you do away with something that's central to your life for a special period of time in order to focus on praying during that time. Right? Whether it's coffee, whether it's sweets, dessert, whether it's a whole meal, right? Whether it's a TV program. Take something out so that you will feel the pain of having that thing missing. And every time you're reminded, man, I wish I had my coffee right now, pray. That's a reminder. I'm going to pray. Man, my stomach is rumbling. Pray. Right? So use that time. Right? But thank you, Beth, for that. That was great. At this time, we're going to sing and worship the Lord through music. So, Kim, if you're able to join us here at the front, if you guys are able to stand up and sing with us, please do. Sing our songs, we're going to sing happy birthday to a few people, okay? We have Mr. Seth Tuesday, is that right? 19, 21? 20. Even better. And we had Eggy. Eggy was, is Eggy here?
I didn't think he was 84.
That's right, Eggy turned 84 on Friday. That's right. And we have
Sarah Ann. Turned 29.
29.
Yeah.
Amazing. You're going to look a day over 27.
79.
79, that's pretty good. Yes, Buggy, did you have someone else's birthday?
No, mine.
Well, it's coming up. We'll sing you that. So let's sing happy birthday. Right, where did it come up? We'll talk about that when it comes. All right, there?
Yep.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, Seth and Sarah Ann, happy birthday to you, birthday greetings today, may God bless you.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Put not your trust in princes, in a son of man, in whom there is no salvation. When his breath departs, he returns to the earth. On that very day, his plans perish. Blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, who keeps faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoners free. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the sojourners. He upholds the widow and the fatherless. But the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever. Your God, O Zion, to all generations, praise the Lord. I found a new song. I texted Tiago yesterday and I said, hey, tomorrow be a good day to sing this song? And he was like, sure, that works. And I had forgotten that you were coming. And then as you were speaking this morning, and I was like thinking about the words of the song, I was like, man, isn't like, I feel like the words of the song are the exact things we need to be saying to these women and these girls and these families who were considering abortion. It starts out and says, are you past the point of weary? Are you, is it all too much to carry? And it's talking about, if that's you, let me tell you about my Jesus. And
are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all its stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes the way. Yeah.
fact, I was just talking to one, and right now is the time where we would go to the nursery, but really we had planned it this way, that a lot of what Beth has said, the scripture that was read, the song that Kim just sang, is really all working together. I mean, is there a better passage to refer to a love life in the church's mission is than Psalm 194:6, right? Don't look to the leaders of the world, the politicians. When their breath fades away, they're going to go back to the dust. Their plans are going to go with them. Does that sound familiar? Right? No, trust in the Lord. He is the one that cares for the Lord. He's the one that cares for the Lord. So, those of you who are doing nursery, are you okay if we cancel nursery today? I'm just going to do a 10-minute reflection. Is that okay? All right. We'll do a 10-minute quick reflection. Children, this is for you. Okay? This is important. And it's only one verse from 1 Corinthians chapter 8. So if you would please turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 8. First Corinthians chapter 8, verse 6. Child in the womb, your life as children who are 4 years old, 5 years old, 3 years old, 79 years old, older children in the back. Children, as you realize, as you notice, the older you get, the further back you move. I'm not sure. There's some type of correlation. I haven't analyzed it just yet, but it's less something.
Steps. Deep.
It's less steps from the door. Yeah, that's right. See, Bobby, he's going against the tide now. But here's, why does life matter? Why do we do what, why should we be partnering with Love Life? Why are we even here? Why should we be going out and proclaiming the word? Why should we be caring about children in the womb or people in their deathbeds? Why is it that life matters? And 1 Corinthians 8, verse 6 gives us this. Life matters. Why? Because God is. Because there is a God. Notice verse 6. There is one God, the Father. If there is no God, then there is no right and wrong. And notice our society. Why is it abortion and evil is so rampant? Because they don't think that there is a God. Look around the world. The societies where abortion and evil and wickedness are so rampant because why? They think there is no God. And so if there's no God, there's no right and wrong. But there is a God. God is. There's one God. And so life matters. Children, this is important. As you grow up, there will be lots of people trying to tell you that this world came to be because of an accident. But if there's no beginning, if there's no God to make things begin, then there's no God at the end. What will you do when you face death? If there's nobody at the beginning, there will be nobody at the end. And if there's nobody at the beginning, there's nobody at the end, there's nobody in the middle, and life is meaningless. You might as well go and kill yourself. And that's what our society is doing. Kids your age, number one, one of the highest rates of death among teenagers is suicide. because they've been told every day of their life that their life doesn't matter because there's no God. But there is a God, and so life matters. But the truth is, it's not just the fact that there is a God, as we see here in verse 8, it's the fact that God not only is, but that everything is His. Look at verse 6, chapter 8, verse 6. There is one God, the Father, from whom are all things. Everything belongs to God. Many people in our society will say, yeah, sure, there might be God, there might be a fairy, a fairy flying around somewhere, a tooth fairy. They think of God kind of like a clockmaker. You wind up the clock, God wound up the world, made it spin, and then He stepped off the scene and let the world do as wherever it wanted. And if there is a God, He's somewhere far, far away in a galaxy far, far away. It's the Star Wars God. Nothing to do with your everyday life. Your choices don't matter. God doesn't care about you. You just need to pursue your best, your pleasure, your power, and just do whatever works for you. What works for you, works for you. What works for me, works for me. Let's just move on. But no, the Bible teaches us there is a God, and everything belongs to Him. And that's why life matters. In the Psalm 146 that we read, in the song that Kim just read, I'm just saying, and in the message that Beth shared with us, we see that there is a God, and that God is the owner of everything, so therefore He's the one who sustains everything. So these women who are going in and pursuing abortion, these men who are trying to push their girlfriends and their wives for abortion, they have forgotten the fact that there is a God who promises to be the Father of the fatherless. That even when it seems like we won't be able to make ends meet, if we turn to Him, He will provide. And how often have we as Christians forgotten this? And we try to trust in princes, in the rulers of this world. As soon as their breath is taken away, they go back to the dust. But blessed are those whose trust is in the God of Jacob. Everything is His. He is, everything is His, He created it, He sustains it, and if it exists, it has a purpose in His plan. Whether it was a wanted pregnancy or not a wanted pregnancy, it would not have happened if God did not allow it. Think about how many of us in here have struggled with pregnancy. Jessica and I, we tried for 5-6 years, we couldn't get pregnant. And you see people left and right popping babies out. When they want it, when they don't want it. Whether they're under birth control, whether they've had surgeries to prevent it, you hear stories of people getting pregnant. And then you have people who try and try and try and never get pregnant. Why is it? Because life is in the hands of the Maker. So whether it was wanted, whether it wasn't wanted, if it exists, it's because God wanted it to. Who are we? How dare we take that away? How dare we say, no, 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 we know better. He won't provide. No, 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 we're not going to be able to make it. No, everything is His. If He brought it to life, it's His. Only He gets to take it away. Just like last week we saw with marriage. If He united it, He's the only one that can break it. But regardless of how difficult it is, He promises to sustain us through it. This is the message. Whether this applies to you directly, whether you have in the past considered this, whether you might even have done it, or not. Because we as God's people are what? His holy people. Life ought to matter to us because we are His holy people. And whether we're the ones considering abortion, whether we're the ones who know somebody, or whether we're the ones who are going to be counted on to dispense God's truth. As the church, you and I are called to be His holy people. The ones who represent God in this world. The ones who show the world, here's what God is like. Here's what He says. Here's the wisdom from heaven. And so whether you are past the point of even caring about pregnancies, or whether you are not even there yet, your day will come where you will have to share God's wisdom with somebody. And you remind them to these 3 points. Trust in the Lord. He is. There is one God. Trust in the Lord. Everything is His. Trust in the Lord. Read again, verse 6. Yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things, for whom we exist. And there is one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things, and through whom we exist. God created all things, God called you to be His holy people, and God sustains you. Through Him we exist. No longer I who live, Christ lives in me, as what Paul says.
Notice what he says in chapter 7, verse 6. We saw this yesterday. Sorry, not chapter 7, verse 6. Chapter 7, verse 14. Look at this. Turn the page or flick over in your phone. The unbelieving husband is made holy because of the believing wife. The unbelieving wife is made holy because of her believing husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean. But as it is, they are holy. Life matters because we are the Lord's holy people. We have holiness that's contagious. We are the temple of the living God. God is moving in this world through you and through me. The world has never seen God, but his love is perfected in us as we love one another, John tells us in 1 John. Jesus becomes visible as we go and proclaim his truth through our love for others in his name. Regardless of your age, regardless of your position in life, if you are in God's family, you have been called to be his holy people, to dispense his holiness around. Or else, how will the children be holy? Or else, they will be impure. There are children out there right now that have no witness of the truth in their lives. And there are some of you in here that God has given the opportunity to, one way or another, be God's presence in that child's life. That's why for us to say no to abortion, we need to say yes to adoption. You can't just tell people, hey, stop abort, if we're unwilling to help them. That's the problem with politicians. That's the problem with the people who just stand in the corner with signposts. God hates abortion. God hates homosexuals. God hates what you're doing. Yes, sure. But God tells us to be his hands and feet in loving those people. And so I don't know what adoption might look like for you. Maybe it is you go and take on one of the 20,000 children in North Carolina that don't have a home. Or one of the 500,000 in the United States that don't have a home. Maybe that's what adoption looks like for you. Taking them, going into the foster system, being a foster family. God paved that way for Jessica and I. And he has blessed and provided all the way through. Maybe that's what he's doing for you. Maybe children, you guys are going to grow up to be a safe haven for some children that don't have parents in their lives. And in doing so, we get to manifest Jesus' presence. Maybe adoption means you go and take on a family under your wings. You adopt a family. You adopt one of these young women. You adopt these couples who need help, who are struggling. And you get to be Jesus' presence in their life. Maybe that's what it looks like. Maybe adopting for you means you might not be in the physical condition to do it, but you might be in the financial condition to provide. Maybe you adopt a family. Maybe you adopt a family that is adopting a child. We know a handful of people who right now are within their first few months of fostering. In fact, Seth's sister and her husband have taken in foster children a month ago, 2 months. We need to pray for these people. We need to support them. When Jessica and I first took in the kids, we were left all alone. Our parents were far away. Our families are far away. We were hoping the church would be our family, and some of them were, but for the most part, we were alone. And it stunk. Right? Stink, stunk.
It's on the video of the
church. That's right. We are the Lord's holy people. If there is a God, and if he is the one who owns everything, and if he really has called us, then don't fear about your position. God somehow, in some way, wants to use you in dispensing his holiness in this world. And I want to encourage you. God has adopted us into his family. What does that look like for you? Maybe there's people in your family that need to be taken in. Grandchildren, great-grandchildren. Maybe there's cousins, uncles, aunts. I don't know. Maybe you need to go to the foster system and sign up to be a foster parent. Could be a temporary thing. Could be a permanent thing. Maybe God is calling you to partner with Love Life and be his hands and feet in that avenue of life. But God is calling us to do something. Will we wait for the princes of this world to do it? Or will we partner with the King of the world, the King of the universe, to be used to be his hands and feet? Once again, there is one God, the Father, from whom are all things, for whom we exist, and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom are all things, and through whom we exist. Will you believe that? Or will we just continue showing up once a week and pretending to believe it? If we believe it, our life will look different. If we believe it, the choices we make will look different. If we believe it, we'll be willing to sacrifice a few years of freedom for the true freedom and the true joy. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks. We give you thanks because your word is true. And even though it's hard to hear sometimes, it's hard to believe and to trust, we thank you that you do not leave us in darkness. We thank you also for the forgiveness that you offer. Father, we know that every single one of us in here we have sinned. We sin, Father, daily when we place our trust in the princes of this world. We place our trust in the politicians, in the rulers. We place our trust in the things of this world that will perish. I just pray that you help us, that you forgive us. That you forgive us and help us to turn our eyes to Jesus, the King of the universe. I pray that you would use us. Use us to be the instruments of your grace in the life of these people. That we would extend the forgiveness that we have received. That we would extend that forgiveness to those who need it. That we would overflow in this life that we've received from Jesus. That we would overflow it in our community, in our families, in our friends' lives. Please help us today to be open to the doors, to be open to walk through the doors that you are opening in our midst. Give us the eyes to see the opportunities. And give us a heart to follow. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
If you would please join with us as we sing one last song, Jesus Paid It All. If you're able to stand, please.
remind you, please, if you have any questions, speak with Beth. If you haven't registered just yet, please do. Even if you're not able to make it, please join us in prayer for Wednesday and fasting and prayer on Saturday. And even if you are not able to walk long distances, we will make a way for you to still be there. Right? We will begin in a shopping parking lot with some songs and prayer and some sharing of testimony, and then we will walk to the clinic. If you cannot make that walk, that's okay. We have rides where you can be taken to the parking lot and can join us. Then we will pray at the clinic. So don't let that be a reason for not going. Okay? Let's say the closing prayer and blessing together. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon us and give us peace. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Have a blessed week and I look forward to